forgot. Thank you to remember.
No problem. Thank you, Professor.
Okay, now you can see the screen, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so, well, we have this Bremsstrahlung radiation that is emitted from this site. And that this is the typical radiation that is used for the X-ray radiography. When we go to the medical doctor and make a radiography, we basically use this principle. And if you remember, we already discussed it a little bit. We will see again that the energy spectra of this kind of beam, if you put the energy of these gamma beams or X-ray beams in this case, because the energy is not so high, if we design the spectra is something like this, where this maximum energy corresponds to the potential difference that we applied here. So if we have, for example, a potential difference of 40 kilovolt applied between the cathode and the anode, then we will have a corresponding maximum energy here for 40 kV. So we will have a Bremsstrahlung spectra, sorry, with a maximum cutoff of 40 kV and with a continuous shape at the lower energy. Well, this again is the principle that I already illustrated to you. So we have this cathode. We have some filament here. Look, this spring-like material. We apply some current, indeed. The current starts to hit this filament, and the electrons by thermionic process start to be emitted. While these electrons are accelerated by a potential difference between the cathode and the anode, they reach this system that is the rotor, indeed, that is this one, and the X-rays radiation is emitted in this direction. We will see when we will discuss the Bremsstrahlung process with more details that the Bremsstrahlung radiation has some preferential difference, and it will depend on the direction of the electrons when they impact the surface of the material. The reason why we have these anodes that have to rotate during the irradiation, you see again this point, this rotate continuously. The reason is that when the electrons reach the anode, they produce, they exchange heat, they deposit energy. So you will observe a very high increase of the heat of the anode. And if this rotates, the electron will not stop always on the same point. So this will permit the cooling, basically, of the system. Because remember that here there is a vacuum. So the exchange of the heat due to the conventional motion, it's practically zero under vacuum. If there is something that heat, you have not the possibility to dissipate this heat. So it's very important to apply some method to cool the system. One of the methods is to put in rotation the place where the electrons stop. But there are the modern X-ray tubes have also cooling system, for example, based on water exchange, on heat exchange, thanks to some water inlets that enter inside, or you have oil cooling system. system or other kind of cooling system. For a typical diagnostic tube, X-ray tubes, we can state that the typical potential difference that are applied here range between 80 kilovolts up to, let's say, something around 120 kilovolts. These are the typical energies that are used for conventional radiography, when you make a chest radiographic image of the chest of some bone. You typically use this energy range. You will study that the lower energies, something between 18 and 30 kilovolts, are used mainly for mammography. While energies between 40 and 100, let's say, not 100, 80 kilovolts are used for conventional radiography. Why, if you have beams with an energy greater than 100 kilovolts and up to, let's say, 140 kilovolts, you use typically this energy for the CT, for the computed radiography. So typical tomographic scan that you will study in the lesson from Professor Russo are based on the emission of X-rays in this energy range, 100 kilovolts up to more or less 140 kilovolts. So the kilovolt is an important parameter for any X-ray tubes, but there is another parameter that is used to describe the efficiency of an X-ray tubes, and is the current of the filament. So for people that will go to work in some hospital in the future, and if you will start to check and to make the quality controls of an X-ray tube, you will learn that the second parameter is the current of the filament. And the current of the filament, what means to what is related. The current of the filament is related to the number of the electrons. Because more is the current that you have in the filament, more is greater is the thermionic effects that you have, and you produce more and more electrons. So more and more electron travels and reach the anode, and more X-rays are produced indeed. So the current is a parameter that somehow is directly connected to the dose, to the fluence of the X-rays that are emitted. And typical current range between 3 milliampere up to 60, 70 milliampere for the bigger tubes. And changing this current filament, you will change the number of electrons. And so you will increase the emission of the X-ray. And indeed, one of the important control parameters that are performed on an X-ray tube is the linearity between the fluence of the X-rays and the current of the filament. You should observe a linear correlation between these two parameters. Well, this is just to go a little bit inside the way in which Bremsstrahlung radiation is produced indeed, and we discussed it already a little bit, but it is better to go a little bit more in detail on this with this team. Well, we saw that we already, let's imagine that you have some electrons that reach the material. So in this case, you have two electrons, one and one. And these are high-speed electrons. What means high-speed electrons? Well, it's some electrons that have a kinetic energy of the order of kV, as we saw before. So something between 10 up to 200 kV is already an energy for which we can say that these electrons are high-speed electrons. So these high-speed electrons, what means? Means that these electrons are able to produce some ionization process. Ionization, as we discussed during the last lesson, is the process in which one electron touches another electron of the atomic orbital in this case, and release some sufficient quantity of energy to this electron to allow for its escape from the atomic orbital. So if the bending energy that keeps this electron connected to the nucleus is less than the energy that is released by this electron, then this ionization process may occur and the electron escape in this direction. If this electron escape here, there is a hole that remains in the atomic orbitals, and some electrons, some other electrons that is less bending, it can be admitted to jump to the lower level for mechanical, following the quantum mechanical rules. So you have the falling down of another electron, and this change in the energy, the level energy, produce the emission of what is called the characteristic photon that we already discussed when we saw, for example, the electron capture process. Well, but the second thing may occur, that is the Bremsstrahlung indeed, in which this particle may go very, very, very close to the nucleus of our atom. So in that case, the Coulomb okay, no, sorry, because there was a communication. I don't understand nothing, but it's okay. So what happens? Happens that these energetic electrons may start we will see with some details this, but what happens is that the Coulomb field of this electron started to interact directly with the Coulomb field of the nucleus. And this Bremsstrahlung radiation is produced due to the change in the direction of the velocity and also in the module of the velocity of this electron. This Bremsstrahlung production is something that occurs at the nucleus level, but cannot be classified as a kind of interaction that is an hadron, cannot be classified as an hadronic interaction, or it is still an electromagnetic interaction. That means that it is still an interaction that occurs between the electric field of these electrons and the electric field of the nuclei, not involving anelastic exchange of energy. But we will see what this means and how the classification between the different kind of the radiation is in the next lesson. Well, this is again a typical spectra from a Bremsstrahlung process, and there is an important point here that should be somehow discussed. This, for example, is a typical X-ray spectra, Bremsstrahlung X-ray spectra, sorry. So this is a typical Bremsstrahlung spectra that you would observe at the exit of our X-ray tube. This is something that, okay, so if you have this electron beam that reach this anode and stop here, we have the production of this Bremsstrahlung radiation in this direction. And if you register the energy of this gamma, of this X-ray beam, so sorry, if you register the energy of this X-ray, you will observe exactly this spectra. So we already understood that the maximum energy is related to the potential difference that you have between the anode and the cathode, but and you have a continuous spectra up to basically the zero energy. So you see, this spectra is something. This is what really is emitted in a Bremsstrahlung radiation. So this means that you have all this part that is composed by very low energy photons. So you have this, all this component is at very low energy. You see, you are below 10 kV up to zero. And this is not really useful for medical application, because if you want to make an X-ray picture or some part of our body, you will learn, not in this course, but you will learn that when you want to make a radiography, what do? You have here the human body, so we have the usual guys here, and we put the X-rays are shooted, for example, in this direction. So you have here the X-ray, and you put here some detectors. So this is some detector. And what happens? Radiation traverses our body and reach the detector here. And you register some information. And this information is our image. So what is important? It's important that the X-ray energies is sufficient to traverse our body and reach the detector. Otherwise, we will not catch any signal here, basically, at the detector level. But if the X-rays has too low energy, this does not occur, because at very low energy, the interaction probability of these X-rays with our body is very high. So basically, all these low energy beams are stopped in the body. And this is not good, because you release some energy in the body, you may potentially produce some damage to the tissue without reaching any useful information. So what is done in the typical X-ray tubes? All this part is cut. It is removed by a filter that is placed in this position here. So in the typical X-ray tubes, you have some very thin foil of some material, typically beryllium or tungsten. So some very thin foil that is sufficient to stop this very low energy X-ray beams and to allow for the transmission of the higher energetic, more energetic component. So the final spectra of an X-ray tube is not the red cube that I show here, that is the theoretical one, but what you will observe is this cube here, the blue one. It's still continuous, it's still not monoenergetic. In some kind of application or in some specific investigation, this is not a good point, because if you will learn that if you have the not monochromatic beam, this can produce a loss in the, for example, quality of the image. But by the way, this is sufficient to reach most of the information that are clinically needed in the investigation. And again, this is again a typical spectra of Bremsstrahlung radiation. So no comment to do here. The only things that here I show basically two spectra. One that has a tail at 60 kV, and another here that has a tail at 100 kV. And in fact, you can see here you have this 100 kilovolt peak. This string here, KVP. This stay for kilo volt peak, and this is basically the potential difference that we apply between the anode and the cathode. Okay, so it is said, okay, when you want to characterize some Bremsstrahlung radiation, you cannot state that the energy is 100 kilo electron volt, because 100 kilo electron volt is the potential difference that you are, for example, applying here. But you will say that and you will have this maximum energy of 100 kilo electron volt, but you cannot say that usually in the medical physics language, what you will say to characterize this kind of spectra is it's more correct to say this beams is a 100 kilovolt peak. That means is a Bremsstrahlung beam that has not one energy because it's continuous spectra, but is obtained applying a maximum potential difference of 100 kV. So kilovolt peak, because you have the peak, is the maximum potential voltage that you apply between the anode and the cathode. And okay, also in this case, you see here unfiltered and filtered. Unfiltered, this is the unfiltered for the 60 kilovolt peak, and this is for the 100, but the concept is exactly the same. Well, now we can move to the characteristic six rays. Before to introduce the characteristic six rays, it is nice to see again this plot. What you observe here? We have this continuous. We have this. Continuous beams, that is the Bremsstrahlung, but we have some strange peaks. Well, this we already saw in the last lesson. I think we briefly introduced. These are called the characteristic peaks, that are the peaks that are generated by the emission of this X-ray when the atomic electrons excitate from one state to another state. And in fact, here there is some of these characteristics X-rays, and the process is explained here. If we have some electrons that stay in some excited state, as we already discussed, then it can decay and can produce this characteristic radiation. In you, in the book, or in the atomic level of the emissions, you will read that these characteristic six rays are called the K alpha or L alpha or L beta, depending on which is the orbital that is interested, the atomic orbital that is interested for this excitation. Well, there is another process that is called the Auger emission, electron Auger emission, that somehow is a process that is in competition with the emission of these X-rays. Why is this competition? Because when we have this electron emission, the Auger emission, what happens is that the atomic excitation energy is not transferred between the emission of the gamma, but is transferred directly to some electron. Okay. This is again a quantum mechanical process, but you can imagine this process like the fact that, here, for example, in this slide that we discussed before, we have this emission of a characteristics X-ray. But let's imagine that this X-ray that is generated here immediately touch another electron of these orbitals and release the energy. So you are not able, basically, to see the emission of this gamma, but you are only able, eventually, to see the emission of another electron that is emitted due to this energy. So somehow you can see this process in a classical way, like this. So you have not the X-ray emission, but you have the absorption of this X-ray emission directly in the atom. This is not completely true. When you discuss the Auger emission in the nuclear physics course, you will see that this is due to a tunneling process, and it's a transferring of energy that is governed by the tunneling process. But by the way, you can see this in this way. And what about? Yes, this you already know. We discussed the production of electron by electron conversion, and this Auger emission is somehow equivalent to the electron conversion. But in this case, the energy does not came from the nuclear, from the nucleus of the atoms, but came directly from the atoms. When you have an Auger electrons, you are dealing with electrons that are generated in the energy range of the KV, exactly like in the X-rays are beams that have energy that are around the KV range, because the difference in energy of the atomic levels is something around the KV, or 10 of KV, or 100 of KV, not more. Okay. Well, how we can generate this X-ray in many ways? These characteristics X-rays, there are many ways in which we can do this. We already understood that at any time in which you send some radiation in some material, you produce a transfer of energy. And this transfer of energy can extract electrons by ionization, but can leave the atoms in some excited state. And if you leave the atom in some excited state, then you will observe this X-ray emission again. So it's exactly the same process that we discussed for the X-ray tube. So it's exactly this. In this case, we send electrons in some material that is our cathode. This electron excites the atoms of the cathode. The atoms decay and produce its characteristic X-rays. So you can do this, but you can do this also with the X-ray radiation, for example. You can excite the atoms with another external source, not electron only, but so you can use X-rays, you can use electrons indeed, but you can use also charged particles that are generated by accelerators or by source. There is a very nice application that is called PIX. That is, for example, the proton-induced X-ray emission that is a very famous technique that is applied to the cultural heritage studies in order to understand, for example, ancient paint or ancient objects, how they are really formed, which are the elements that compose these forms. So, for example, in the pixel, you will shoot low energy or medium energy protons, some materials, and you observe the emission spectra, the emission X-ray spectra from this. And studying the peak that you observe, you understand which are the elements, that are the elements that compose your target. And starting from this knowledge, you can understand, for example, the period in which this object was constructed, or which are the characteristics. You can have really many information on material, not only, of course, in cultural heritage, but the characteristics X-rays are used, for example, in the industry, or in order to check if manufactured material are good or not, or have some defects or not, or which is the real decomposition of objects. So this is a typical use of radiation in order to study material, and this is really an important field of the applied physics. So I want to tell you this because you may understand that applied physics is not only medical physics, but applied physics, also in the case of radiation, may be connected with some other important activity for the human development and for the society development. Okay, as we discussed, that this is in this picture, you can see another way in which you can generate X-ray radiation. So this is the case of the use of an alpha source. So to much details, basically you have a source of alpha that may be the polonium or the curium that emits alpha, and you have embedded some target, for example, of beryllium. So you, in the same place, you have an alpha source with some beryllium target, that is this one, and then you have the emission of the characteristic X-rays. So, as we discussed the electron source, alpha source, you may have some characteristic X-ray source that may be of interest for your laboratory activity. Well, let's move a little bit to something of bigger, that is, for example, the production of X-rays using some accelerator machine that are the synchrotron. What happens in the synchrotron? In the synchrotron, you usually, it's a circular accelerator. You will study this kind of machine during the lessons on accelerator, if you follow the classes of accelerator. But by the way, the typical beams that is accelerated in a cyclotron is the electron beam. So usually you have these electron beams that turn in some circular orbits. But what happens? Happens that when the velocity of these electrons that run inside the we have electrons that run inside this circular big accelerator. But even if the energy, the kinetic energy of these electrons is not changing, you have still a change in the velocity, because you have still a change in the direction of our velocity vector. And this means that parts of this you will observe an electromagnetic radiation, because as you know, when you have a change of the velocity, you will observe still this radiation that is called synchrotron radiation. So the synchrotron radiation is something that is observed when you have some charged particles that change its direction. And also in the case of protons, in principle, you may have, even if this conversion from the kinetic energy to the synchrotron radiation is more efficient for lighter particles. So this is clearly visible for electrons. And it is to have such kind of radiation is interesting because you may have some energy that can be varied from few electron volt up to the typical X-ray energy of the X-ray tubes, so typically 10 up to 100 or 200 kilo electron volt maximum, and it can be really very intense. So you can reach very, very, very intense, very bright source of X-rays that may be used in any application. And today there are really research center, one is in Italy, in Trieste. There is a very famous center that is called Electra, Trieste. And in this center, there is a big cyclotron in which they accelerate electrons and they produce synchrotron radiation to make different studies. Important things of the synchrotron radiation that is not mentioned here is that this radiation is monochromatic. So the energy is not continuous, but it's a very well-defined energy, depending on the velocity of the electrons and on the change rate of the velocity. And this is really important because in such kind of center, if you need to make studies with very intense source of monochromatic fixed rays, you can have. And today, for example, there are many studies on the mammography. The mammography or mammographic image is one of the most important image technique in medical physics because a tumor inside the breast is typically difficult to be seen because it can be very small. So you need really a very high spatial resolution to look inside the breast and to see also this very small tumoral formation, aggregation of cells. And the conventional mammographies are made with the typical Bremsstrahlung radiation. You have detector with very high resolution. You will study this in another class. But if you use monochromatic radiation, you can really improve of factor four or five the spatial resolution of your mammographic system. And indeed, there is this mammographic system based on the synchrotron radiation that is something on the frontier of the medical imaging. Unfortunately, these synchrotrons are not available on the hospital. So today you cannot have in the hospital some mammography that is made with X-rays from a synchrotron, of course. These are just studies based on research studies. Okay, let's move to the another way that we can use to produce electromagnetic radiation, let's say. We are discussing in general of electromagnetic radiation in these last few lessons. And another way is the production of the so-called annihilation radiation. We already discussed this. It's generated when a beta plus particle, or also called a positron, annihilate. The annihilation process is the recombination of this positron with an electron, and it generates this Q gamma of 511 keV each. Because when the electron and the protons basically suffer this fusion process, all day mass, that is 111 kV each, indeed, is completely transformed from the mass in the electromagnetic radiation. So it's a typical quantistic process in which you have transformation of mass to energy. The total mass of the system is the sum of the two mass, electron and positron, at the same mass. So you have this quite symmetric process in which you have this positron and this electron that found together emitting one gamma in this direction and one other gamma in this direction, and the energy of the gamma is exactly the half of the two. In the most simple case, is exactly 550 kV. And we already know how to produce this beta plus. We saw two different examples. One is the radioactive decay. During the first lesson, we studied the beta plus radioactive decay. So there are elements that decay in beta plus. But there is another process, that is the pale production process, that we will study in the next lesson, in which that is exactly the symmetric process of the annihilation. In this case, you have a gamma, and the energy of this gamma, if the energy of this gamma is bigger, so exceed the sum of the two gamma of the mass of the two electrons, so it's bigger than 1.022 MeV. So in this case, the gamma may produce one beta plus and one beta minus, so one electron and one positron. So exactly as the opposite of the annihilation process, so we have this pale production process in which an electromagnetic radiation can be converted in mass. And we will see that this pale production process is one of the most important competitive process for which the gamma rays are absorbed in the matter. We will discuss this because they may be of interest and of importance in medical application as well. Okay, this is some explanation of the annihilation radiation. And there is this case, I want to underline just this part of these slides, because this, let's say, strange annihilation that is called also annihilation in flight, so during the movement of the positron, maybe we will see that may be of interest in the dosimetric, the radiation dosimetry, in the way in which we will learn to calculate the dose. Now I will come back in the next lesson on this effect. What is important is that when we have this annihilation in flight, that means that you have this positron that is moving and it annihilates with electron when it is not completely stopped. So in this case, the photons that are generated can carry with them a little bit of the kinetic energy of the same positron. So this means that the annihilation photons, the energy of these annihilation photons, is not exactly 0.511 MeV, but maybe a little bit higher, because it can, for the energy conservation, it can bring within some kinetic energy coming from the movement of the positron. This is a very, let's say, secondary effect in the case of the annihilation, but it we will see that it may have some importance in the evaluation of the absorbed dose. Okay, the final part of this lessons related to the source are dedicated to the neutron source, but I will not discuss in detail because we will have at the end of the course a specific lesson on neutrons, generation of the neutrons and interaction of the neutrons with the matter, especially the low energy neutrons, because the low energy neutrons are the one that are produced in many environments related to the medical physics, and they are of importance because the neutrons contribute to the dose, to the patient, really. So we will have a dedicated lesson on this. I just here report some way in which we can produce the neutrons, but we already discussed it, for example, this slide, when we discussed the, you remember, the fragmentation, the spontaneous fission, fission of the nuclei. We discussed that during this spontaneous fission, we may have also the emission of other particles like protons, gamma, and the neutrons as well. And so the typical case is, for example, the California 252 that we already discussed, in which you have this emission of two fragments that are with the distribution that we discussed, but we have also the emission of the neutrons. If you remember in the slide of the last lesson, there are some typical fission reactions in which one or two neutrons are emitted. And this is a typical spectra of neutrons, and here the scale is MeV, so these are quite high energetic neutrons. Usually this energy with energy bigger, these neutrons with an energy bigger than one MeV are not so important in medical physics, because usually, let's say, this is not completely true, of course, but the cross-section of interaction of these neutrons with the human body is generally low. So in medical physics, we are typically interested in neutrons with energy that is below 1 MeV. This is really just for the dosimetry, let's say, application related to the radiation dosimetry, or for the contribution to the dose of the neutron in radiation dosimetry. If we have neutrons that are generated by for example, the gamma rays from a linear accelerator, then in that case, things change, because you have the patient that is directly below a gamma beam that at the same time produce a neutron beam, because we will see that these neutrons can be produced also with the photo emission process, that are the emission of the neutrons when gamma interacts with the material. And in that case, this production also at this energy is not negligible. So again, we already discussed also this, so I will skip the slide, the production of neutrons after decay and alpha decay, or after, sorry, not after decay, but after the interaction of the alpha with the beryllium that we discussed in the last lesson. So I will not come back to this. And these are the typical commercial neutron tubes that you may have at the lab, and that are really a combination of something that emits alpha and some material that is excited by the interaction of the alpha. So you have a target, typically you have a beryllium target, so you have a source of alpha, this alpha reaches the beryllium and it produces, generate some reaction like this one, where you have, for example, the emission of the, so you have in the same source, you have this, for example, the polonium that emits alpha, and it is closely connected to the beryllium layer, and you have the production of the carbon, in that case, in the excited state. Remember that this carbon may emit also a gamma radiation, but you will have also the neutron production here. Okay, spontaneous fission we already discussed, so I will skip this. Photoneutron reaction, this is a case of some importance in medical physics. Why is important? So what is the photoneutron reaction? Well, basically, we have some gamma. And if this gamma has an energy that is sufficient to produce a nuclear reaction, because this is really a nuclear reaction, so it is a reaction that occurs at the nuclear level, at the level of the nuclei of our atoms. So if you have this gamma that is here linked with the HNI, so with its energy, that interact, for example, with some beryllium, then you may have the conversion of this beryllium 9 to beryllium 8 with the emission of a neutron. This is a typical nuclear reaction that is called the photoneutron reaction. So it's a nuclear reaction induced by the gamma ray. And why this is important in medical physics application? This is important because, unfortunately, you have energetic gamma, so gamma with energy, let's say, between 10 to 25 MeV. You have this gamma, for example, when you treat a patient with the linear accelerator. So in a linear accelerator, you typically treat the tumor, irradiate the tumor with gamma beams that are still bremsstrahlung beams, but are most energetic. But the energy of these gamma beams range between 10, 8, up to 25. So you have an energy that is sufficient to induce this photoneutron reaction. And this photoneutron reaction produces neutrons. If you stay in a linear accelerator bunker, when this linear accelerator produces photons, you will have a big component of neutrons that are produced in reaction like this. This is not the only reaction, of course. When photons of such energy interact with material, they have a probability to induce this photon-neutron reaction and to induce the production of neutron flux that may be dangerous for patients and operators of the accelerator. So the photon-neutron reaction is useful for research. You need some neutron source, but may have some drawbacks in the case of the use of photon in radiation therapy. Okay, I think, okay, here there are few slides on the radioactive decay. I think that you know very well the radioactive decay, so I don't want to take time to speak about things that are really on the basis. By the way, in the next lessons, during the exercise, we will discuss some typical exercise that will involve indeed some the radioactive decay law. And so I reported these two slides here so that you can use this formula that you already know surely in the exercise that we will discuss. Okay? So radioactive decay, I mean, is on the basis of what we discussed on the last few lessons. So I suppose that the process, it is, let's say, it is a rule that an approach that you already know. Okay, so for today, I think that we can move to Giada. Giada, you can join to the team. So now, Giada, I decide to make, okay, really 20 minutes, not at every lesson, but sometimes we can have just 20 minutes of discussion about some experimental research that we perform in our group that is connected to the medical physics, of course, so that you can understand which is the activities that we perform in our lab, but also to give you an overview on the real, on the medical physics activity or activity that are mostly related to research that you can do in the applied field. So now I will say. So just a moment, I stop the screen broadcasting. I go here. Okay.
Così c'è qua, no. Dov'è?
Vuoi vedere che non lo puoi fare? Che ti dovevo dare forse qualche privilegio.
Non so dove farlo. Come si fa?
Faccio io.
Ah, solo gli organizzatori possono condividere elementi. E allora io non posso sharare lo schermo.
E come faccio a darti? Allora?
Io ti posso mandare le slide, però.
Forse il proprietario del team può rendere, può dare il controllo delle slide a chi deve presentare qualcosa.
Direi, dottore.
Can you see the screen?
Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen? Can you see the screen?
Can you see?
Sì, sì.
Yes.
Ok, perfect. Aspetta, aspetta. Ok, dai. Finally, we was able to do this. Ok.
Poi play? Loro lo vedono giusto?
Okay.
Okay, can you see the presentation?
Yeah. Yes, yes, we can.
Okay, we want to spend a few minutes to show you which are the arguments for the thesis if you want to work with us, with our group. We have an official website. Here reported a screen of the site. You can see that, I don't know, you see the mouse? Mamma mia, vado qua. On top is written home members activities and also thesis opportunities. We decided to spend a few minutes in different lessons to explain you the different thesis arguments. In fact, if you give a look in the website, you can see that we have more than thesis arguments that you can follow for your work. Today we'll spoke about the proton-boron reaction. Especially here, I reported the two different arguments for the thesis. For the proton boron, there are two different applications. One is.
Sorry, we don't see the if you change in the slides or not.
Okay.
No. Now you see.
Yes.
Ma quali slide vedo qua? Aspetta, ah no, perché il
problema è che non lo so perché quando tu non condividi tutto. Mamma mia. Ma dove caspita è? Ok. Ok, you see the mouse, no?
Yes.
No, yes.
Diciamo così, da non ingrandire.
Here I reported the two different arguments regarding the proton-boron reaction. In fact, you can see that we have two topics. The first of all, I reported the application of the proton-boron capture therapy in clinical applications. You can see that there is a short abstract, but I will explain you in more details why this reaction is important for the future applications, for the radiotherapy applications. And then you can see another topic. Again, we have the proton-boron reaction, but in plasma, that is a bit different because in this case, it's not strictly related to the medical application, but it's just the study of this reaction in an environment that is completely different to the conventional when you have, for example, a beam, a monochromatic beam that interacts with a target, and you have then you have particles that are emitted, and you study the reaction, of course, the cross section and so on. So, okay, we can start with the clinical part. Probably you already know the trend of the dose deposition in the tissue. For different radiation type. Here I reported, you can see the electrons, the the carbon, X-ray and protons, just to show you that for the clinical application, the carbon ions, but also the protons, are interesting because you have a local deposition of the dose that is very precise inside the tumor. This means that if you treat a patient, the deposition of the dose inside the patient is completely different with protons as respect to the conventional radiotherapy, for example, with X-ray. Here you can see the picture of a patient treated with X-ray and proton therapy. For a medulloblastoma, yes, is reported, and you can see that the dose distribution in red is close to the organ that we have to treat with the radiotherapy, and in the healthy tissue, in the case of the proton therapy, we don't have any energy that is released on the healthy organs. So this means that proton therapy is interesting because you can release those in a very precise way. This means that we have a reduction of secondary tumors that are produced during the treatment. But okay, we are very very precise dose distribution, but for the radiobiological point of view, the efficiency of the protons is very similar to the X-rays. This means that we are not able to treat, for example, radioresistance cancer in an efficiency way. And this is the reason because in the last years was investigated other techniques that are different to the protons. For example, here you can see the different relative biological effectiveness distribution in a patient if we treat a patient with different ions. So this is a caption of the treatment planning system. You can see the different distribution and of RB with different colors. And it appears clear that the RB in the case of the proton is very, very low. But if we increase the Z of the ions, for example, for the if we use the oxygen, the RB is extremely high. So this means that, for example, we can imagine that it's better to use these heavier ions as respect to the protons. But you can also see that if we have the tumor that is this one, this white region, we have, if we change the ions, we have also a dose surround the tumor. This means that we have a sort of compromise between the higher RB and an higher local dose tumor probability, control probability. Other techniques that in the last years was investigated are based on the increasing of the relative biological effectiveness in the tumors. For example, here I reported the example of the nanoparticles that are injected inside the tumors, or the target alpha therapy, or the multiple ions. In the first two cases, you can imagine that a drug is injected inside the tumor and then a reaction is triggered by an external beam. In this way, you can have a local increasing of the RB. And in the last cases, the multiple ion treatment planning system is based on different ions. So you can imagine to treat a patient by using more than one ion. So in this way, you can reduce the dose surrounding the tumor and increase the RB. Okay, in the last 3 years here in Catania, we start to study the proton boron fusion therapy. The idea is to insert inside the tumor the boron atoms. In this way, we can trigger a nuclear reaction, because if you treat a patient with proton beams and you insert inside the tumor boron 11 atoms, you can see that are produced free alpha particles. Yeah, I reported the different reaction channels just to show you which are the reaction that is more interesting for us, because there are three different reaction channels, but with three different cross sections. In pink, you can see the higher cross section that is of the order of one barn, in correspondence of low energy proton, incident proton beams. It's I reported the resonances. You can see that we have three different resonances at very low energy. 150 kV, 675 kV, and 2.64 MeV. For the other two reactions, the other two channels, the cross-section is very, very low. So essentially, we observe this production of alpha particles thanks to the production of beryllium-8 and the consequential decay. In the end, we have these three alpha particles that are produced exactly inside the tumor. This reaction is extremely interesting because you can, if you image to treat a patient, you can use the proton to emit these alpha particles with a range that is of the order of 10 micron in the tissue. This means that you can damage directly the DNA of the cells if you are able to insert the boron inside the cells. And in this way, you can also increase the RB because the LAT of the particles that are emitted, the alpha particles, is extremely high. For example, if you just to give you a number, for the protons, the LAT is of the order of the maximum LAT 20 kV per micron. In the case of the alpha particle, we can have 100 kV per micron. This means that the RB is extremely high, exactly in the position where we have the tumor. In addition, thanks to the interaction of the protons with the boron, we have also the production of the prompt gamma ray. Here I reported the energy. This means that in principle, we can also monitoring the treatment and where exactly the proton interacts with the boron. In this way, we can are sure about the treatment. Here I reported the main papers about this. The first the idea of this technique was proposed in 2014, and then we submitted a patent thanks to a collaboration with the Elbim Line Institute in Czech Republic. And in 2019, we performed the first in vitro experiments. I will show you the details, but basically we radiate biological samples and we observe the damage at the cells. And in 2017, we studied also the prompt gamma ray. Okay, regarding the thesis work, just to fix the idea, you can, for example, image to work in two different topics. First of all, the Monte Carlo simulation of the radiobiological irradiation to predict the damage. This means that, for example, you can image to simulate the cells and through the GM4 DNA code to predict the damage at the DNA level. And or you can use the biological models that are currently used in the treatment planning system. You can we can image, for example, to modify the some parameters of the biological models to predict the damage due to the presence of the boron inside the cells. Another argument is the measurement and estimation of LAT variation due to the presence of the boron atoms. This, in this case, you will use, you will perform microdosimetric experiments, you use specific detectors with a dimension that is similar of a cells. In this way, you can measure the LAT. You can compare, for example, the standard LAT with the protons, and the LAT increased thanks to the presence of the boron. And then, for example, you can image to calculate the RB thanks to the measurement of LAT in the exactly conditions that are the clinical conditions that are completely different to the standard nuclear reaction with the vacuum chamber, target, and beam. In this case, our idea is to perform an experiment in proton therapy center in the configuration that is close to the configuration adopted for the treatment of a patient. And just to give you other details, show you other details, for example, here you can see the facility here in Catania, installed the IAT LNS. In the picture, there is Catania. here we treat patients affected by ocular melanoma. And here you can see the Monte Carlo simulation of the beam line. You can see that we have simulated the different elements of the beam line, for example, to modulate the beams. Here there is the modulator, or to change the energy. Here there is the range shifter, but also the detector. We have simulated everything to reproduce the exactly condition that we adopted during the treatment of the patients, and we have used this application that is already now is implemented in GM4 and is in the public version of GM4. But we used this application to reproduce exactly the radiobiological irradiation that we perform to study the proton boron reaction. So for the experimental point of view, we here you can see I reported the details. we used this proton beam configuration. Here you can see a spread out break peak that is typically adopted for the treatment of the patients, and we decided to put our cells, the biological samples, exactly in the center of this spread out break peak. So we irradiate the cells, of course we insert the boron inside the biological samples, and we observe the variation in the survival fraction. So you can see here that is written SF and dose. This means that we have a different percentage of cells that are damaged after the irradiation in three different conditions in this case. So you can see that we have the X-ray, the black points, the proton without the boron, red one, and in green and yellow, the point with the boron. You can see that the percentage of the cells that are survived after the radiation are different in the two cases. This means that we have an RB that is higher to the standard irradiation with only one protons. And thanks to this experiment, we can affirm that we have an effect in the cells due to the emission of the alpha particles. In the direction to try to reproduce this effect, for example, in our case, first of all, we tried to estimate and calculate these alpha that are emitted. Here you can see the output of the Monte Carlo simulations, the different, this is the proton energy at the different position along the spread out break peak. And then we estimate the number of the alpha particle produced in the different position of the dose distribution. And then we applied, for example, a standard models, And we have tried to reproduce the observed biological damage. This is just an example, of course, because this is the first study that we performed. These results was published 2 years ago, more or less, I don't remember exactly, but now, for example, we are trying to simulate a real cells. In this case, our idea is to use the M4 DNA code. Here you can see that there is the link. I want to show you this one. Posso usare questo? Questo? Come lo faccio vedere? Aspetta.
Che senso?
Qua. Un coso qua.
Aspetta.
Volevo aprire il link.
Sì, sì. Aprire questo. Quello è questo qua, il link?
Sì, l'ho copiato.
Ah, l'hai copiato? Che mi sta scaricando il codice. Perché non lo apro?
È più difficile.
Allora, mi sta scaricando il file.
Okay.
Questo dice?
Sì, sì, sì.
Aspetta, no, io ora duro così.
E ti volevo far vedere la cellula.
But it's not shared. No, it's not shared. Sì, sì, però.
Ma perché non li possiamo condividere qua?
Aspetta. Allora, aspetta. Share this.
Condividi il quadratino, quello schermo là.
Non so quale, aspetta. Ah, screen 1 o screen 2?
Okay. Screen 2.
Ok. You see? You see?
Yes, we can see.
And now you can see the browser?
Yes.
Okay, just a moment. Ah, okay. Okay.
Okay. I want to show you the official Gen4 DNA webpage. Okay, here you can see two examples that are already implemented inside the code. For example, this is a tissue, and you can see that, of course, this tissue is composed by different cells, and you can see that there is the beam that interacts with this tissue, and we have different energy that is deposited in different position, and as output of this example, you can see the amount of the damage inside the tumor, for example. Or in this case, you can see a single cell that is irradiated by one radiation. I don't know what is probably a proton, I don't know.
Probably
a gamma. I don't know. You can see that, for example, in this case are produced the radicals, because in this case are activated some chemical processes to simulate two things. The direct damage, this means the direct energy that is released on the DNA, but also the secondary damages that are due to the radicals that are produced inside the cells. Ora io devo tornare indietro.
Aspetta. Okay. Ah no, aspetta, in questo caso puoi fare questo.
Ok. Okay, of course, I will share with you this slide, and this way you can also give a look on the website. And there is also available virtual machine where is already installed the Gen4 and especially already compiled the Gen4 DNA examples. In this way, if you want, you can play a bit and you can see the output of the simulations course. And just to give you additional informations, this technique is extremely interesting. Here you can see an article that was published in the journal La Sicilia, probably you know. And you can see that is is extremely interesting for the clinical applications because it was also founded for more or less 2 million of euros in two different projects, Neptune and PBCT. In fact, we collaborate with different institutes to study this reaction in different point of view. You can see that here reported, for example, the different working package group of Neptune project. You can see that we have a working package that is dedicated to the modeling of this reaction. Then we have the microdosimetry, radiobiology, the experimental activity, but also the imaging and the quantification of the boron, for example, that there is inside the cells. Okay. For regarding the laser plasma interaction and this reaction that can be studied in this extremely condition, in my opinion, first of all, it's necessary to spend few words about this new this new concept for the study of the reaction. The idea is to study, in our case, the proton-boron reaction in plasma. This plasma is released by the interaction of the high-power laser with a solid target. For our experiment, for example, that generally the target is composed by plastic and boron, because we want to study the emission of the alpha particles that are produced by the interaction of the protons with the boron. But practically, basically the idea is to create an not stable plasma thanks to an interaction of a laser with the target. In this case, you can see that is released a regime, generally is released a regime that is called the TNSA. And in this regime, the target is destroyed by the interaction of the laser with it, and is created a plasma composed by all particles that are in our target. And the interesting thing is that when the laser interacts with the target, you have, first of all, the emission of the electrons, because the mass of the electrons is lower as respect, for example, of the protons or other ions. This means that it's created a potential that accelerate the protons. And in our case, in the case of the proton-boron reaction, these accelerated protons interact with the borons that are in the plasma. And then you can study this reaction. Just to show you, yeah, there is a simulation. You can see the laser that interacts with the target and then the other particles that are produced. You can see that, first of all, are emitted the electrons here, and then the other particles in all the directions. Okay, and just to give you other informations, we perform a different experimental run in Prague at Pulse, the Prague Asterix laser system, and here, for example, you can see some pictures of our last experiments. Here you can see the interaction chamber. There are several optical elements inside the chambers because you have to focus the laser in the target. Here we have the target. And then you can see also here. And then we study the emission of the alpha particles in different directions, thanks to the using of the several detectors that are fitted at different angles inside the chambers. For example, here you can see a tube. Here we have four tubes in total, because a technique that we use, this is the time of flight technique. Okay, just to show you the sketch of one configuration that we adopted, you can see the laser that is focused on the target, and then, for example, at different angles, in this case, the detector. Silicon carbide and time of flight configuration, CR39 that are passive detector, and a spectrometer to distinguish the different protons, particle species that are produced in the reaction. Okay, regarding the CR39, I don't know if you know this detector, is a passive detector. You can see it's very simple. It's a plastic layer. When you use this detector, you can have an information of the energy spectra of the alpha particles that are produced, because through an electrochemical action procedure, you can distinguish the all created by different particles that interact with the detector. Here you can see, for example, a typical picture that you can acquire thanks to a CR39. And you can see that, for example, in this case, we have different circles that represent different alpha particle structs inside the detectors. And then, thanks to the information of the area, we can correlate the dimension of these tracks with the energy of the particles. And so we can know, for example, the energy of the alpha particles that are emitted. Regarding the time of flight technique is different, because this technique is based on the using of solid state detector, for example, diamond, silicon carbide. In our case, we prefer to use the silicon carbide, but the technique is very simple. If you know which is the distances between the particle emission and the detector, that here in the picture is represented by this arrow and with the L, you can convert, if you measure the time, the arrival time of the particles in the detector, you can convert this time in velocity of the particles and then in the energy. So you can convert your spectra acquired with the oscilloscope in energy. In addition, if you know which is the temperature of the plasma, you can also know which are the different ion spaces inside your signal. For example, this is a typical time of flight signal. If we use this equation, if we know which is the temperature of the plasma, we can deconvolve the signal and know which are the ion spaces that are emitted. Here, for example, this is a typical signal that we acquire. You can see that we have this higher peak, first of all, that is the peak of the photons that are emitted in the interaction. Then we have the electrons here, and then the ions, protons, but other ions that, for example, compose the target. And just to conclude, for example, this is another time of flight signal, and this one is different because it is the signal acquired by using a Thomson parabola. You can see that we have these different parabola that are due to the different ion species and different mass of the particles that are detected. Regarding the argument of the thesis, for example, in this case, you can give a contribute in the analysis of our data acquired with different detectors, but you can also, for example, participate in different experimental campaigns because in the future our idea is to continue this work and perform this experiment in plasma also in other facilities, not only in Prague. And I don't know, that's it, if you have questions.
Thank you, Giada. No, as you saw, we wish to present this part now because this is somehow connected with the nuclear reaction, no? It is the alpha, the proton on boron 11 that produce alpha. That is a typical reaction that in the last three lessons, we discussed a little bit the way to generate particles from the interaction of protons or secondary radiation, and this is a typical case, no? The proton plus boron 11, it produce 3 alpha, so it is really a source of alpha, secondary source of alpha. And it's interesting. It is interesting also for this for energetic application, you saw, because it produce this 3 alpha, and it generate also a lot of energy. Each time that proton touch the boron 11, it produces 3 alpha with the emission of 9 MeV in terms of energy. That means the production of energy, indeed, without neutrons. And in fact, this is one also of the candidate for the future fusion projects, like the deuterium, tritium, one of the possible reaction for the ignition project and starting of the fusion production of energy. Is the proton boron 11, because it produces really a lot of energies. And yeah, we are still in the research field, but it's one of the possibility. Okay, so there are questions on for some part of these lessons?
No.
So the next lesson that will be next Thursday, we will discuss about we will start about the studies of radiation interaction with matter, and then we will move fast towards the definition of the most important quantities in radiation dosimetry. Perhaps last time I will start with the definition of some quantities in radiation dosimetry, so we can enter directly in the most important part of this course. And then we can come back to the interaction of radiation interaction with matter, because perhaps in such a way you can learn better why it is important for in general, but especially when you deal with detector and medical physics application, the process that govern the interaction of radiation with matter and how to measure them, basically. Okay, so thank you. Have a nice weekend. And
thank you.
We can see together again next Thursday.
Thank you, Professor. See you.
Bye-bye. Thanks.